Bona tarda. Gràcies per acompanyar-nos en aquesta sessió d'Una tarda amb, que forma part d'aquestes activitats del concurs Tenor Vinyes en aquesta 58a edició. Soc en Víctor García, director artístic del Gran Teatre del Liceu. I m'acompanyant amb enorme plaer aquí a la taula Sònia Ganassi, Elena Pankratova, Sònia Ganassi. Dues rellevants veus en aquesta sessió d'Una tarda amb que s'inaugurava fa molts, molts anys en la primera ocasió amb la gran, gran Renata Tebaldi. I per tant, és un moment d'aproximar-nos a aquestes grans veus que fan enormes i grans els nostres escenaris, ens emocionen per la seva qualitat vocal, per la seva expressivitat, per tots els elements que configuren aquestes grandíssimes veus. Aterrant una mica, inicialment començarem per la Sònia Ganassi, aquesta mezzo-soprano avui dramàtica, nascuda a Reggio Emilia, formada amb Ellen Villard, guanya el concurs d'Espoleto i immediatament té la seva oportunitat de debutar a la Rossina a l'Òpera de Roma, del Barbiere de Sevilla, l'any 1992, bel cantista d'entrada, rossiniana, encarna les grandíssimes heroïnes rossinianes, Elisabetta Regina d'Inghilterra, la Dona del Lago, Hermione, Mosè in Egipto, alguns dels primers rols que ella firma amb una gran autoritat. De seguida s'interessen els grans temples de la lírica i per tant passarà pel Metropolitan, pel Covent Garden, per l'Escala de Milano, Viena, el Teatre Real, París, San Francisco, però també el Gran Teatre del Liceu. Batutes molt preuades com Antonio Papano, Claudio Abbado, Riccardo Chailly, Riccardo Muti, Myung-Whun Chung, Wolfgang Sawallisch o Marcello Viotti, entre molts altres. Els rols que han configurat la carrera de Sònia Ganassi van des d'una mezzo-soprano bel cantista a rols una mica més de mezzo-soprano dramàtica, que en la seva extensió van des de Vivaldi fins a Berg, però per citar alguns, s'ha fet molt, molt coneguda i molt popular per la seva Adalgisa, la Leonora de Favorit, Rodelinda, Dorabella, Dona Elvira, Niclós, Cherubino, Noce di Figaro, l'Angelina de Cenerentola, Isabella, l'italiana in Algeri, la Giocasta, en Edipus Rex, segurament un paper més oratorial, l'Evoli en Don Carlo, del qual ha signat també un gran cavall diguem, en la seva carrera, del Don Carlo, l'Amneris, Charlotte de Verterre o Carmen de Bizet. Ja veieu que la paleta és enorme. I una mica en la configuració de la seva estada, no?, de Sònia Ganassi al Gran Teatre del Liceu, podem parlar del seu debut a la Maria Estuarda, en la Elisabetta, en el rol d'Elisabetta, en la temporada 2003-2004, la Evoli del Don Carlo 2006-2007, la d'Algisa la Norma el 2006-2007, un concert dedicat al compositor Gluck el 2007-2008 i finalment la Giovanna Seymour de l'Anna Bolena la temporada 2010-2011. Buenos días, Sonia.
Buenos días.
Gracias por estar con nosotros. Quería empezar un poco hablando, preguntándote, ¿cuál fue el primer gran éxito de tu carrera?
El primero, el primo, ha estado el debutto que hai nominato nel gennaio del 1992 con il Barbiere di Siviglia. Io ero una sconosciuta, giovane, che cominciavo e ho avuto una grande opportunità perché io facevo copertura di Rosina e all'ultimo minuto chi faceva il ruolo di Rosina si è ammalato e io ho fatto la prima recita ed è stato veramente un grande successo. Questo è il mio inizio che ricorderò sempre.
Hay una multitud de directores, de batutas, de maestros, de grandes maestros muy, muy importantes, muy relevantes. La lista la hemos repasado. En tu opinión, en tu recuerdo, ¿cuál es el maestro que más te ha impactado trabajar con?
Difícil decir esto, porque ogni grande directore da qualcosa di importante que te porti per tutta la vita. Se devo dire, forse un incontro straordinario è stato quello con Claudio Abbado. Ero molto giovane e ho cantato il Barbiere con Claudio Abbado e per me era veramente, ero emozionatissima a incontrare, io avevo 26 anni e incontrare Abbado, un mito, è stato veramente molto, molto importante. È molto importante, ma veramente difficile dire molto importante il primo Verdi che io ho fatto con un grandissimo direttore, Antonio Pappano. La prima volta che ho fatto Verdi, Requiem Verdi, è stato con lui che e ho imparato tantissimo. Ma la lista è veramente lunga. Sì.
Grazie. Passaríem una mica a presentar Elena Pankratova, gran soprano, soprano dramàtica, nascuda a Rússia, formada al Conservatori de Moscou, ha estat formada com a directora, com a pianista, com a cantant, però actriu.
Sant Petersburg.
Sant Petersburg. Sí. Però també formada en el repertori italià amb Renata Scotto, la grandíssima soprano. Coneguda el 2010 a Florença, a Firenze, a partir del rol de Die Frau von Schatten, és un dels rols significatius en la seva carrera, però després s'interessen els grans temples de la lírica, Múnich, Covent Garden, la Scala de Milano, Bayreuth, el Teatro Colón de Buenos Aires, Unter der Linden, etc. etc. I també unes notables batutes amb qui ha treballat, des de Zubin Mehta, Christian Thielemann, Kirill Petrenko, Valery Gergiev, Ken Nagano, Semyon Bishkov, Jan Andrea Noseda, Jonathan Nott, per mencionar alguns de les grans batutes. De gran sensibilitat, gran tècnica, forta presència escènica, és la primera soprano russa en 140 anys que trepitja a l'escenari de Bayreuth, amb dos rols, Kundry el 2016 i Ortrud, de Lohengrin el 2019. Jo vaig estar presenciant la seva Kundry, extraordinària, moment, diguem, antològic, en la primera vegada que jo trepitjava el teatre de Bayreuth i, per tant, tinc un enorme record de la seva Kundry, però els seus rols van des de l'Odabella d'Àtila, Electra, Turandot, Sieglinde, la Leonora del Trovatore, Amelia, Tosca, Ariadne of Naxos, la Leonora també de Forza del Destino, però també l'extraordinària Abigail de Nabucco, un dels rols també molt, molt difícils. És veritat que s'ha prodigat poc al Gran Teatre del Liceu, però va debutar la temporada anterior, 2019-2020, amb la Santuzza de Cavalleria Rusticana, que vam tenir l'oportunitat de gaudir tots plegats. Welcome, Elena Pankratova.
Buenas tardes.
With all these roles, I would like to go back to the first, to the beginnings. What is the first important role you had in your life?
Well, every first role is important for the singer, of course, and you will never forget the first experience to survive the first performance of your life on stage. You know, for me, it was if we talk about the opera, it was the Safi in Zigeunerbaron in Nuremberg. It was a big role. Safi is it's operetta, they could say,
but
it is Johann Strauss, and written very, very difficult for soprano. So as Safi, you are leading the whole ensemble, and you are, I would say, Safi, it's a small sister of center, something like this, yeah. And you have to be all present on stage and with beautiful aria, duets, and all this stuff. So really, it was a big experience for me. And immediately, 1 month later, the first Italian role was Amelia in Ballo in Maschera. So it was my first year of in this profession. Not easy. I didn't have a childhood in the theater, you know, like small roles. First, you try here, there, something Mozart of that. But immediately Contessa, if Mozart, you know, and immediately Tosca and Ariadne. So how it started, and then. It's actually was a very good period, and the directors it was in Germany, and the directors were talking in between, and immediately I went through the whole Germany to see Amelia in Ballo in Maschera, and later Ariadne also. So it was how it started.
Heavy, you know. Stuff, huh?
Yeah.
From the beginning. Yeah,
from the beginning.
Stuff,
yeah? Yeah, no jokes.
Yeah. What about the maestros? I was asking Sonia also, yeah. Which is the maestro which was very important in your career?
Well, though I was singing already maybe for 10 years different repertory, the whole Verdi, I made very many roles of Verdi already in Puccini and so, and some of small from Wagner, not small, Elizabeth in Tannhäuser I did, and Saint I did already, and Gudrune, and Dritte Norn, and I don't know what. But the discovering of me was 2010 in Florence, and Zubin Mehta, Maestro Zubin Mehta, was the one who really would say presented me to the big opera world. And when one day I was seen in the Latin Tora, Dias' wife in La Mujer Sin Sombra, yeah. And from Richard Strauss, and it on this day actually the whole opera world was there, and all the managers, all the artistic directors, you know, Scala, I don't know, from all over the world, all over the world, and also it was director Rai. In radio, and yeah, somehow next days the day the newspapers were open with the title, the discovering of the evening was Russian soprano Elena Pankratova. Though I was the absolutely comparing to my colleagues, not necessarily the known one, you know. So it was big names in the cast, but you know. So and also as by Sonia, it was a replacement of another singer, actually last moment situation, you know.
Good opportunity.
Good opportunities, exactly. And now looking back, I felt how crazy I was to agree to jump to step into this role, you know, because when Maestro Mehta suggested me to do so, it was 3 weeks before the premiere. 3 weeks, you know, with this huge role, you know. I said, but Maestro, I'm very honestly, I have no idea if I can do so, because it's the biggest, the dramatic, most dramatic, most demanding, most long role I ever sung in my life. But he trusted me, he knew me already from another productions, and he said, don't worry, we all will help you. And it's really how it started, really how it helped. So it's, of course, it's Maestro Mehta, it is Kirill Petrenko, it is Christian Tilleman, Hartmut Henchen, Semyon Bychkov. It's all people who really played a big role in my career.
Fantastic. We're going to get started. Anem a continuar, a començar una mica el visionat dels vídeos que hem preparat pel públic, per aquells espectadors que ens estiguin seguint pel video streaming. M'agradaria començar amb la Sonia Ganassi cantant Si vuol di Franchil Regge, de Maria Estuarda, l'àrea, l'entrada, diguem, no, del primer acte de l'Elisabetta. És un moment fantàstic. La Sonia Ganassi va cantar al Gran Teatre del Liceu, i aquesta és la gravació precisament del seu debut al novembre del 2003. El que m'agradarà és que, d'alguna manera, Elena Pankratova comenti, després, un cop haguem vist el vídeo, comenti sobre la Sonia Ganassi, i després farem el joc una mica a la inversa.
Oh, Oh.
Estas eran las primeras notas de Sonia Ganassi en el Gran Teatro del Liceo y desde luego ha habido una lista de enormes éxitos, pero realmente es inolvidable esta noche. No sé, Elena, ¿cómo lo has visto?
No, it's fantastic. And you see what really impressed me, that you see the young person, don't know how many years you stand on stage before you sound this, I don't know, you know, but full of energy, full of personalità, you know, and with such a bel canto, really bel canto, and such
the style,
a,
yeah? The style,
the style
of bel canto.
The style, the how the voice is yeah. You know, is held, and technically and from expression here, just fantastic.
Full of colors.
Full of colors, matices, yeah, and, yeah. You know, mm. And you hear this strong lady behind, and yeah. Which is what we like about Sonia, you know.
Grazie. C'è una cosa molto divertente posso raccontare di questa serata, perché era il mio debutto al liceo, wow. E dopo quest'aria che l'aria apre l'opera, e c'è stato veramente questo grandissimo applauso che insomma avete sentito, e io ero così felice e sono in preda all'emozione, sono uscita, perché era in forma di concerto ma facevamo entrate e uscite, e io sono uscita e così dietro le quinte. Peccato che dopo dovevo cantare un recitativo ed ero fuori, perché ero in preda alla contentezza di questo grande applauso, mi hanno buttato dentro. Bello. Questo è un episodio divertente, sì, di quella serata.
Ora sì che sarà il turno mica d'ascoltare l'Elena Pancratova, e faremo una mica il mateix exercici. La Sonia le preguntaremo che opine sobre questa prima intervenzione de Elena cantando la Oda Bella en el prólogo de Attila, Santo di Patria, que en una grabación en el Teatro Mariinsky de San Petersburgo al desembre de 2014.
Thank you.
Elena?
Well, it's funny to see now after a couple of years, and of course there are no professional microphones, you know, which therefore you hear it's live from the stage without any microspot something, interesting. And
Sonia, how do you see it? Come l'ho visto?
Penso che questa voce è impressionante, ma io conosco Elena, ovviamente l'ho sentita al vivo, lei ha una voce impressionante, la vera voce da soprano drammatico d'agilità, perché sentite che anche se, come dice Elena, i microfoni non erano professionali, si sente la massa di voce, una voce così, no, così, non ci riesco, ma con tutte agilità, acuti, note basse, veramente impressionante. In più questo ruolo, Odabella, è un ruolo terribile, perché ci vuole una voce drammatica, ma è un Primo Verdi, quindi c'è tutto il bel canto dentro e quindi agilità, come i soprani, l'estensione, perché i soprani di bel canto erano così, cioè veramente estensioni molto lunghe, note molto acute, ma anche note molto basse, quindi chapeau Elena.
Grazie.
Molt bé, continuarem veient dos altres vídeos una mica que il·lustren dos cavalls forts, diguem, dintre del recorregut de les nostres convidades d'avui. En aquest cas, el Don Carlo, per la Sonia Ganassi, ha estat un ruolo molt important, la Eboli, per te.
È stato un ruolo importante. E questa edizione che sentite era il mio debutto nel ruolo di Eboli, nella versione francese. Importante, non l'ho fatto Eboli tante volte, devo dire poche volte ho fatto in scena, però questa è stata una bellissima produzione e una molto bella che è stata il Don Carlo al Covent Garden con la direzione di Tony Pappano.
Si els nostres oients volen mirar una mica, només posar Sonia Ganassi al YouTube o Don Fatale i totes les referències, versió concert, versió escènica, són realment d'una enorme contundència, d'una enorme potència. Jo crec que, sense més preàmbuls, hauríem d'estar escoltant la cançó del Bel, diguem, de l'Eboli, en aquest Don Carlo, gravació del Gran Teatre del Liceu el 27 de gener de l'any 2007. Oh. Locura de personaje, Éboli, es maravilloso, pero tiene una contundencia, ¿verdad? Es muy, muy complejo, muy, muy complejo. En el caso de Turandot y Elena, it's really very attached to you, the role of Turandot. And I would like to suggest hearing you in Questa Regia, in which we can find the very cold Turandot, but really which has also a soul, yeah, something magic inside her. Yeah, let's see. Podem escoltar en Questa Regia en la gravació que es va fer a Firenze el 14 de desembre de l'any 2012. preciosa grabación, magníficas las dos grabaciones. Veía a Sonia que estaba casi cantando y se me aparecía en la mente una pregunta. Si no hubiera sido mezzo-soprano, ¿qué rol le hubiera gustado cantar?
Tosca.
Tosca. ¿Y tú, Elena?
Well, if I would be tenor, maybe I would love to sing Tristan, but as soon as I'm going now, looking forward for my first Isolde, I have no wishes.
That's very, very demanding. You're doing the first Isolde in some weeks, hopefully, in Valencia, yeah?
Hopefully, yeah.
And you are prepared for that?
Yes, yes. If the situation will allow us to go and to make all the rehearsals and everything, then, yeah. I really look forward for this. Oh. It's,
and Sonia, yours, you have an immediately performance. ¿Qué es lo que tienes inmediatamente?
Un Requiem di Verdi, sempre in Valencia, con Daniele Gatti.
Ah, fantastico.
E poi a Valencia un Cavalleria Rusticana.
Wow, Santuzza.
Sì.
Muy bien, muy bien. En el imaginario, a veces todos tenemos nuestras leyendas, ¿no? Imaginarias. A veces nos, como cantantes, os podéis reflejar, mirar en el espejo de otros cantantes. ¿Qué otros cantantes pueden ser importantes? ¿Qué habéis seguido para aproximaros a algún rol?
Io all'inizio della mia carriera, i primi 10 anni di carriera, quando ho cantato tanto Rossini, perché per 10 anni ho fatto Barbieri, Cenerentola, Cenerentola, Barbieri, Barbieri, Cenerentola. Io avevo un modello ideale, che voi conoscete molto bene, che era la signora Teresa Berganza.
Claro, y más para estos roles.
È stato veramente, quando ero studiavo, io sentivo tutte le cose di signora Berganza.
¿Y por qué? ¿Qué es lo que te gustaba en ella?
È tutto. Lo stile, il modo in cui faceva l'agilità, la modernità del suo canto, tutto. E anche quando ho preparato Carmen la prima volta, che Carmen era un ruolo importante, io non avevo mai fatto ruoli così, e io ho studiato tanto sulla Carmen di signora Berganza, tantissimo.
And for you, Elena, is your model?
Yeah, for me it was Renata Scotto for Italian roles, and for German, certainly Birgit Nielsen.
And what about Gena Dimitrova? Is something that you were hearing time to time? Or?
Yeah, I mean, Gena Dimitrova, I mean, I adore her. She had an incredible voice, you know. Yeah. Incredible voice, and also I discovered her many recordings in a repertory which I didn't expect her that she was singing actually. And but you know, when you hear the Dimitrova, you don't understand it is really the technique or maybe the nature more, you know. Yeah. And of course, with Scott, it's there is a lot of technique, also a lot of temperament, and a lot of. Intelligence, you know, so and the interpretation, which makes me absolutely fascinating me, and by Nielsen, it's always this wonderful way of seeing, very very schlank wie die deutschen sagen, yeah, so very precisely the voice is placed and everything, and so never pushed, never over. Doing, you know, so it's fantastic. And as example, is she for me a big example for the Elektra and for the of course Isolde and for the Brunhildes and you know. So always when I need to study in your role, I say let's see if Nielsen sang and recorded somewhere and how many. Of course, she recorded everything, you know. And a funny thing actually, I met her in the Neue Stimmen competition in Germany. She was in the jury, and I was singing Liu in the first. around. And then I came to her to ask some advice for some feedback, you know. And then she said, yeah, I don't remember your name, but I remember your voice. You sound Liu, didn't you? I said, yes, Signora. Okay, so listen to me. You were very good, but with this kind of voice, you shouldn't sing Liu, you should sing Turandot. You know, and I was like, in the beginning of my career, I even didn't stay on stage, on the opera stage in those times. You know, I thought, wow. Turandot is only for the goddess, you know, this kind of role. Who am I, you know? So, and she saw this in my eyes, and she said, I see you don't believe me, but wait, and in some years you will see that I'm absolutely right, you know.
So, she was right. She was
exactly.
Right.
Exactly. That's what, how it happened.
Hemos estado esta semana, han sido miembros del jurado también del concurso Viñas de la 58 edición. Hemos visto casi 90 voces, ¿no? En una semana muy densa. Ha habido unos ganadores ayer que estamos escuchando mañana en el concierto final. ¿Cómo habéis valorado a los cantantes? Y de alguna manera, viéndolos todos, sin nadie en particular, sí que me gustaría que dieran un consejo, para cerrar un poco la sesión de hoy, un consejo para las jóvenes generaciones de cantantes.
¿Un concierto? ¿Cosa?
Consejo, one tip, un consejo, un
advice.
Advice, yeah.
Advice, un consiglio.
Yeah, yeah, sí, consiglio, consiglio. Per lei.
Sì, io ho un consiglio che vale per tutti i giovani che ho sentito in questa settimana, certamente di studiare, di perfezionare la tecnica, ma la cosa più importante per me è di imparare lo stile degli autori che cantano, perché Verdi si canta in un modo, il repertorio tedesco in un altro modo, il repertorio sempre, cioè lo stile, il fraseggio, lo stile del imparare, studiare di più questo proprio, lo stile degli autori che cantano, che non è tutto uguale. Il fraseggio non deve essere generico, questo è un consiglio più grande, anche di ascoltare tanto, perché io quando ho cominciato, prima mi hai chiesto chi ascoltavi, ma io quando ho cominciato a studiare, noi non avevo YouTube, quindi io compravo Brava. Un disco, perché non potevo comprarne cinque, non avevo i soldi, ne compravo uno. Adesso i giovani possono ascoltare tutto quello che vogliono ed è molto importante farlo, ma non per copiare, ma per imparare, perché è come è importante ascoltare i colleghi grandi, importanti, è come no? È uno studioso che dice no, io non leggo i libri, no? Io leggo i libri per imparare e io ascolto per imparare. Questo secondo me bisogna fare di più.
Lena,
absolutely, absolutely right. I agree 100%. And you know, I have my class in the University of Graz. You know, and also always talking to my students, I say, please listen to the recordings. Not because I want you to copy them;
exactly.
It's not possible anyway. But please listen to the recordings, and not only of the singers of nowadays, because you know, something is coming to me and telling that they are listening. Wow, wonderful colleagues from today. You know, Netrebko, Garanča, Erwin Schrott and so on, you know, so, but okay, lovely, but you know, I said, the opera started not with Schrott or Garanča, it existed already many years before, you know, and the people who were holding it on their shoulders, you know, in those times, what names can you tell me from 50th years, from 60th years, from 70s, oh, you asking terrible things, they say, you know, they have no idea about the names and the traditions,
yeah,
and the traditions, you know, and yeah. What the people achieve in this repertoire, you know, they were good in. And so, I mean, it's a big treasure they have today. Nowadays, you even don't need to get up from your sofa, you know, and you have all the recordings in your computer, so in YouTube, whatever. And just use it, develop yourself. And plus, study languages, study different languages in order to be able to sing their roles in their original language and not because of you only and the conductor and the colleagues around, also because of the public, because you should always think that one day you will sing French repertory in front of French public, Italian in front of Italian public, German and so on, you know, Russian. So study it properly and search for your repertory. Always try to find a different repertory, even if your teacher maybe not give you this advice and say, no, you are Rossinian or you are Mozart and don't look for something else. No, because every repertory, new repertory you touch, develops your voice and discovers your voice with the new facets, with the new colors, with the new abilities. Since I'm singing many pieces of Richard Strauss, my voice developed and opened in the way I never expected before. Now I'm studying Isolde, for instance. Yeah, I'm going to prepare my first Isolde. Isolde gave me the new colors, the new abilities for the voice I never expected before. You know, we were talking another day. Yeah. So it's so interesting, you know. If I would always stay, I don't know, in Verdi or in only in Wagner, it would be too poor because every repertory helps the other repertory, you know. Somehow it develops. So stay developing, stay searching, stay look for the people who can help you in this, you know. So, open the mind for different opinions and different repertory and languages and all this stuff. So.
And what about personality? Because sometimes there's the ingredient, the final element.
Like what I said before about Sonia, because you can see in a very, very young person, you can see already this personality, you know, the strong, and the person who knows exactly what she wants to tell the world. And this is really what we had couple maybe of times in this competition, you know, this time. Same. I was missing the personalities but from the other side, I know it from myself. I was listening to many people. I said, why the person whom I know personally didn't apply for this competition? Because the personalities, many times they think they are not good enough and they don't apply. See. Because they are working and working and working on themselves the whole life through, you know. But the time to take part in the competitions is limited in the life. I think for tenors it's
35
for tenors.
Yeah, and for the woman is 32.
32, you know. 32, well, from the part of the vocal technique and development in this profession, you're a baby still, you know. Yeah. You're making your first steps in the profession. And many people, I know it because I did the same mistake, maybe. I never applied for Vinyas, for instance. I was here in Barcelona in Maria Canel's competition. I became a finalist. But somehow I didn't try, I didn't trust myself to go in this such high level, you know. And now I think, yeah, actually, why not, you know? Yeah. Because
You should have tried.
Yeah, because many personalities, they have doubt that they are that good enough to participate, you know?
Mm. Sì, il problema della personalità è che si può studiare tutto, si può studiare la tecnica, si può studiare le lingue, si può imparare a fraseggiare meglio. Io non credo che si possa imparare ad avere personalità. O ce l'hai o non ce l'hai. Questo è il problema.
Sì.
Quindi lo studio ti può aiutare a tanto, tutto. Bisogna studiare, ascoltare, studiare tecnica, studiare da un bravo spartitista per imparare lo stile, studiare le lingue, sempre. Ma non solo quando sei giovane, anche noi studiamo sempre. Continuiamo a studiare sempre. Ecco. La personalità, o ce l'hai o non ce l'hai, non si impara.
Indeed. But tell me, Sonia, if I may ask, come bambina, tu, stava come bambina, tu già voleva essere un cantante e già saputo che fai questa carriera, professione?
No, io non sapevo, io ho scoperto la musica molto tardi, ma è vero che dal primo momento c'ero dentro la musica e questo istinto questo non lo hanno sempre detto, dicono altri di me, non devo dire io, ma è
innato.
La personalità è qualcosa che veramente puoi cantare male, ma avere qualcosa che conquista chi ti ascolta.
And you, Elena, you wanted to be a singer from the beginning, from when you were a child?
Singer or not, I don't know. I was singing my whole life, you know. I was a girl and we had a very popular song in very famous in Russia, you know, about the, Cinderella, you know. So, and I love the song and my parents always wanted me to sing this when the guests would come, you know. They would put a chair, I would stand up on the chair and say, Хоть поверьте, хоть проверьте. You know, so it was the, they liked it when I was singing, and somehow I was always participating in the chorus in school, in many concerts, all the stuff. Okay, but it was not the, I didn't really think that I'm getting in this kind of profession, getting a singer, professional singer, never. But somehow, in me, inside, already as a girl, I knew I'm going to achieve something special in my life. I mean, I don't want to sound arrogant or something like this, you know, but I always had this idea, something going to be very interesting about my life. It's going to be, you know, the feeling was there.
Ladies, thank you so much for your time, for coming here, for being members of the jury in the Venus competition. And, well, you make big our stage here in Liceo, so you will be very welcome to come back. I gràcies a tots els oients per estar seguint-nos en aquest streaming d'aquesta sessió d'una tarda amb, en aquest cas, amb la Sònia Grassi i l'Elena Pancratova. Elena Pancratova, Sònia Grassi.
Gràcies.
Gràcies a tots vosaltres. Gràcies.